guys, welcome to the first annual Shorts Thanksgiving Dinner. This is some crazy idea I just cooked up because, you know, here at Shorts, we're kind of like a family, you know. You guys are like my brothers, like, like Zach and the tall one. And so anyway, I just want to start off, everyone go around and say something you're thankful for. So I'll start. I'm personally thankful for this lovely Thanksgiving meal that we've been blessed with. Now don't talk. Okay, so let's start off with Sam. What do you want? What are you thankful for?
I am thankful for Mr. Schaefer's support and all of his words of inspiration.
And microphones. Can somebody use a microphone once in a while? Lower third, sports. Do you guys even like people?
But Mr. Schaefer, we go hard.
What you just said is the most insanely idiotic thing I've ever heard. At no point in your rambling did you have a coherent point. Everyone in this room is now dumber as a result. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul. Back to what I was saying.
And I am thankful for the incredible Mac Durson and all his hard work and effort for Whitman Shorts. He always produces timely products, completely appropriate, and very relevant to Whitman.
We just collect plates with young children's faces painted on them, preferably from the ages of like 4 to 6. I tried to start this club online, but I got a lot of strange responses on Craigslist. So if you're interested, just stop by.
I'm really grateful for everybody's hard work and just getting projects done on time and doing your work just amazingly well.
This is the worst. This is.
I'm just really thankful for Whitman Shorts.
Hi, I'm JD Stillwell.
And I'm Frankie Shapiro.
And this is a very special Thanksgiving episode of Whitman Shorts.
Hey JD, are there any movies you're excited about seeing?
I don't know. Are there?
I don't know what that is.
You what?
What are you doing?
Come on, come on. Do, do, do.
What are you talking about?
I can't even do this with you. I can't even do this with you.
JD, you know I've never seen Harry Potter. Let's kick it to Sam to see what movies he's talking about.
Hey Whitman, this is Sam Berman reporting from Whitman Shorts. Today we're going to talk to Cinema Society about all the movies they've seen this year and what they think the predictions are going to be for the Oscars and awards season this year.
Hi, I'm Selvi Ilison.
And I'm Greg Freeman.
And we're both admins of Cinema Society, as well as Angie Ames, who's not here right now. Well, there's some top contenders, I would say. Jurassic World, all were like really action-packed, had a lot of good directors, good cinematography, stuff like that.
I am going with Black Mass, which gotta give it up to Johnny Depp, you know. I mean, he's got his edge back, that's for sure.
Well, a lot of the times it's the director that has like a large impact on it. Like, you'd always see like the best picture movies, their directors are also nominated for best director. So it's a lot of that, and it's also a lot of like production. Like, usually the movies that have been thrown the most money will get like really good amount of nominations in the Oscars. Also, I would have to say, like, really good graphics and, like, special effects. Movies that have, like, Oscar veterans already in them. You know, people who've established themselves as really good actors, actresses, always reappear for nominations.
Yeah, I would say that a lot of the movies that aren't, like, as well produced don't really get their share of Oscar nominations, because most of the movies like that are being made by like big companies are kind of like they already know like the perfect formula to like get Oscar nominations, like the best actors, the most money, like the most produced.
This has been Sam Berman reporting from Whitman Shorts. We'll check back with you when award season is over.
Hey, JD, Katie, does your family have any Thanksgiving food traditions?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we have one. And it's like really weird. So like you can't like judge me for it or anything.
Okay.
Okay. So you go like to the store, like Safeway or Giant, like wherever, like you can go wherever. And you walk until you find like a sack of potatoes. Like just like a massive, like a sack of potatoes, like this big sack, okay? And you bring it home, you lug that thing home, and you set it down on your kitchen counter, and you just start taking out potatoes. You're just like one, two, like three, like roughly, like you should have like 10 potatoes, like 10, okay? And then you take this weird like little thing.
Like a scraper?
Like a scraper. Like a scraper. And then you just start scraping them. You scrape like one, like your 10 potatoes. And then you just have like a bowl of naked potatoes, just totally naked, 10 potatoes. And you just start smashing it with like a smasher. And then you eat it.
Yeah, okay. That's called mashed potatoes.
What?
Mashed potatoes.
It's called potato smash. I didn't even tell you that. How did you know? Potato smash.
No, mashed potatoes.
Stillwell potato smash.
Everyone does it.
Nobody else does that. Nobody else does that.
Okay. Well, let's go to Kaylin to see some other Thanksgiving food traditions.
Hello, and welcome to Kaylin's Cultural Thanksgiving Cooking Show. To make Greek butter cookies, first you need 1 cup of softened butter, 3/4 cup of white sugar, 1 egg, 1/2 teaspoon of vanilla extract, 1/2 teaspoon of almond extract, 2 1/4 cups of all-purpose flour. Senior Alex Bissering shared his Korean Thanksgiving experience.
나는 제일 좋아하는 시간은 Thanksgiving입니다. 너무 좋아요.
Thanksgiving is a very prestigious holiday. A lot of Korean people around America celebrate it.
내 제일 좋아하는 거 먹고 싶은 거는 green beans 하고 sesame 하고 turkey 먹고 싶어요.
One of his favorite dishes is sesame green beans. He also enjoys turkey.
내 family 같이랑 Thanksgiving 같이 보내서 하고 싶고 좋은 시간 보내고 싶어요.
It is a very unique holiday because there is a mix of Korean dishes as well as American dishes, and his whole family gets together for it.
To make Korean sesame asparagus, you first need a stalk of asparagus, 3 tablespoons of sesame oil, 1 tablespoon of rice vinegar, 1 tablespoon of lemon juice, 1 teaspoon of fresh grated ginger, 2 tablespoons of sesame seeds, 1/4 teaspoon of kosher salt.
This has been Kaylin Petrides cooking for Whitman Shorts. Have a happy Thanksgiving.
Thanks, Kaylin. That was really What are you doing?
I'm reacting.
To what?
I'm reacting.
Oh, well, let's go see what other Whitman kids react to.
Hi, this is Devin Pierce.
And Caroline Chue reporting for Women's Shorts.
We quiz students and teachers on their knowledge of current teenage vocab.
Let's check out Women Reacts.
Moves are like when you're looking for something to do, you text your friends, ask if they have any moves, and it's just like things to do on the weekend.
Moves is a term to describe a party or a social event. Typically on a Friday or Saturday night.
That's so wrong. It's dance moves.
Sure.
It's like,
that.
You know.
It's really just when you're disappointed at someone or something, you know. Someone takes your the spot you usually park in. You know, there's no actual parking spots at Whitman, but you know, you don't come early and you see someone in your spot and you just think SMH.
SMH means shaking my head.
SMH. I've seen it.
Squad means like your friend group, like your homies, gang.
That is a smaller group, like as in the cheerleading squad. but probably referring to a small, close-knit group of friends.
Exactly. Often referred to as squaw.
I mean, hashtag squad goals. Right?
Squaws.
And you know, when you're in a bad spot and you just think squad, and then you don't even need to say it, and your squad will just show up on your doorstep, usually with, you know, as Jack was saying, moves in mind.
That's a good question.
That sounds like it's inappropriate. I'm not going to FOMO anybody because I think everybody's equal.
FOMO is fear of missing out, made popular by Drake. Pretty sure. Maybe. I don't know. That was a guess, but I think it's Drake. And it's like when you're grounded because you got a C and your squad goes out and they're having a good time and you're just sitting there with FOMO, fear of missing out. They're going to make some memories, some inside jokes that you're not going to be a part of.
I've personally never used FOMO, probably because I am the party. And so if I'm not there, then everyone else is missing out.
Hey, JD, do you know what the weather report is?
I think it's cloudy with a chance of Ari Nugaborn. It's Ari.
We've all been there. The sheer panic when we realize that we know absolutely nothing on an exam. Or when we know literally nothing because we cheated on every test we took.
I'm talking rainforest sweaty. I'm talking swamp sweaty.
In a stunning 9-0 decision, Montgomery County actually elected to eliminate final exams. Yet what seems like a positive change may have uncertain or even negative implications for Whitman students. Let's say what actually is going to happen now that exams have been eliminated.
For grades, the board is currently deliberating four options. Option one being a percent average, option two being a quality average, option three being a trend grade, which means your grade would trend, and option four being a teacher-made exam. I then sat down with veteran teacher Bob Mathis about his opinion on this change.
About this topic of exam changes, next year there are going to be no more final exams. Just as a teacher who's been teaching here for a long time, what is your general perspective on this?
My perspective was, first, I was disappointed that the Board of Education made a major policy without consulting with teachers, students, parents, stakeholders on a significant policy without giving us much of an input. Then only after I read about it in the Washington Post did I get a question like, what type of exam remodification would I like to see? And teachers only got input after the fact. So the big question we were never able to address was, do we want to change it at all? It's a tough question. I would probably say I would like to have a teacher exam.
So with teachers concerned and students confused, I sat down with the guy in charge, current SMOB, BCC rival, and friend, Eric Aguerici.
Thanks for having me, Ari. So which of the four options are you most interested in? As we know, we have a board meeting coming up, which will explore the four options, which I mentioned earlier in this segment. But which of the four options are you going to vote for, and why?
When the board meets on the 12th, we'll be discussing the grading options. And I was proud that over the past few weeks, we went out to our schools, we went out to our student body. We actually had a focus group here at Whitman with folks from central office and myself, and we talked about these four grading options to see which one really worked for the students. And when you come away with that, option two, which was the qualitative point system, was the option that I supported, that students unequivocally supported. And I was proud that just recently I got a call from the teachers union, from the principals union, and the principals are supporting these options.
So what's the consensus about this change? Teachers are mainly concerned, as 70% of them in a new Bethesda Magazine poll disapprove of this change. And as Mr. Mathis said, there could be significant implications to teaching and proctoring exams. Yet students are just mainly confused if they'll still be able to get the A. However, Upper County authorities like the SMOB told me that everything will be okay. But clearly, only time will tell. This has been Ari Nugaborn reporting for Women's Shorts.
God, you know what I love about Thanksgiving? Soccer.
Football.
Let's throw. Get it? Throw it over to sports.
Danger! Stunts!
Yeah!
Oh.
Hi, Whitman. I'm Zach.
And I'm Sus.
And here are today's top sports stories. First, we go to our specialist, Olivia Lobsens, on the field with field hockey.
Hey, Whitman. This is Olivia Lobsens reporting for Whitman Shorts. Let's take a look at the field hockey team in their final game.
The field hockey team ended their season successfully with a winning record. With key players like Rachel Berman, Tammy Stanger, and Jenna Hawk, they were able to be a strong force going into playoffs. Field hockey team suffered a close loss of 3-2 in the final minutes of their first playoff game against Walter Johnson. Although this was a devastating loss, the girls are still proud of all they accomplished in the season and in the last game.
So we definitely all like played really well as a team, and we had like great passing, and unfortunately it didn't go our way, but that's okay because we have a really awesome 4 years.
Yeah.
And we've been playing like so well with such awesome people, so it's okay.
Thanks, Lobson. That was sick. Now, let's spike it to Francis and Trier for volleyball.
Hi, women. This is Caroline Trier reporting live from the girls' first playoff game against BCC. Let's take a closer look.
Girls' volleyball had an excellent regular season. Part of the team's success is attributed to talent and team chemistry. However, first-year coach Erica Chow has had a serious impact as well. Chow coached the girls to a very successful season, with wins over WJ and Clarksburg through her coaching techniques and unique practices. I spoke with junior captain Maddie McGill and key player Claire Nagelhout about the effect of their new coach.
Yeah, we do a lot of technique, also competition though, so it's a good mix, and we really work hard at practices and get a lot done.
Definitely just to focus on the basics of the game instead of like getting in your heads, just focus on the fundamentals, like getting the right pass, the right set, and then a strong hit at the end of the play.
The girls were successful in their first round of playoffs against BCC, but came up short in the second round against rival Churchill. Congrats on a great season, girls.
Now we take it to Colin Grant for sports science.
That's right, sports science.
Hey Whitman, Colin Grant here reporting for Short Center. Today, I hit the Short Science Lab with Viking star Shaquille Dabodi-Loeb to get a deeper look at his unique physique and talents. Let's take a look. Shaq stands at 6 feet 4 inches. This is in the 99th percentile for his age and only 2 inches shorter than confirmed giant Eli Schnerson. The average human's wingspan is the same as their height, but Shaq's wingspan is a freakish 6'10". His height and wingspan allow him to get buckets over defenders with ease. Shaq has 2,120 followers on Twitter, while 80% of users have under 50. He only follows 999 people, giving him an excellent 2.1 follower-to-following ratio. His hands are 9 inches from the end of his wrist to the tip of his middle finger. The average male hand size is only 7.5 inches. Shaq's vertical of 34 inches is about equal to the abilities of a juvenile kangaroo. His kangaroo-like vertical and oversized hands help him palm the ball and get high enough to throw down sick dunks. From Walt Whitman Short Science, I'm Colin Grant.
Thanks, Colin. That was pretty sick. Now it's time to take it to the pros.
Sus
and
Zach
on
soccer
playoffs
and
plans after playoffs.
Despite an unfortunate loss in the second round of the playoffs, the boys and girls soccer team still had a very strong season. The girls dominated many of their opponents throughout the season, and the boys rallied together to create a tough defense and aggressive offensive unit. Although this loss marks the end of the Viking season, many of your Vikes aren't hanging up their cleats quite yet. We talked to seniors Chris Whittle, Davey Mason, Kate Morrison, and Lindsay Wicken, who are all committed to play soccer in college. These Vikes are both excited to thrive on the field and in the classroom at these excellent schools.
I'll be playing soccer at Bowdoin College next fall. I decided to go to Bowdoin sometime in the summer, and what I really liked about the school was not only its strong academics, but its strong soccer program. I really enjoyed talking with the coach, and her attitude towards the program and improving it really drew my attention and made me fall in love with the school.
So last May I decided to play soccer at Georgetown University. I decided to go there because the soccer program is really strong, and I wanted to stay close to home so I could see my family and things of that sort. And D. Voigt really influenced my commitment, as he was my idol throughout high school.
I committed to Dickinson College in Pennsylvania in early September. And what really drove me to make that decision was when I stayed at the campus overnight, I got to know the teammates, and they were like all really nice and chill. And it also has strong academics and a nice campus.
I'll be playing soccer at Haverford College next fall. I decided to go to Haverford over the summer. And what really drew me to Haverford is they have the education program that I want to study, and I fell in love with the team when I visited.
Good luck in college, you guys, and to Whitman soccer next year. This is Jake Suskind.
Thanks, Whitman. This has been a very special edition of Whitman Shorts.
Well, it is brilliant.
It's beautiful.
It's back.
And it's better.
It's not that much better. It's not that much better.
It's Whitman Briefs.
Next week, the Women Art Department will be hosting a trip to New York, and to be honest, I will go, but as you guys can see, I'm already kind of a city punk, you know, I just love New York, I like to get up there every other weekend, you know, you guys wouldn't get it, but just the culture there is incredible, you know, it's just like that New York flair, you know, that's the smell of hot trash and sewage just running into your nose and just tickling your nostrils, it's really amazing. I love the city. MCBS recently decided to eliminate final exams from school curriculum, and now instead teachers will be accepting bribes. I recently bribed a teacher, Miss Egan. I gave her this picture of just me absolutely shredding licks with my boy Colin Sullivan. Sadly, she did not accept to bump my grade from a 62% to a 91, but oh no, you win some and lose some. On December 3rd, teachers will be able to participate in a free yoga session held in the TV studio. I will also be providing my own unsanctioned yoga experiment. I'm going to be honest, it's going to be brutal, okay? It's not for the faint of heart. It's going to be 12 hours, 90 degree heat, no water, no lights, no surrender, okay? Serious inquiries only. Zoom out for me? Okay. Get it.
So, Shafa, what did you think of Braves?
It was better than last episode's.
That means it was a masterpiece. So, anyway, hope you guys enjoyed it. Happy Thanksgiving, Whitman.
Well, Whitman, that's all for shorts. I'm JD Stillwell.
And I'm Frankie Shapiro.
And have a wonderful Thanksgiving.
Yeah, enjoy your turkey, your pie, your mashed potatoes.
Your potato smash. Please, potato smash. Your potato smash.
Potatoes.
Your potato smash. Potato smash. Potato smash. Come on, Frankie. Potato smash. Potato smash. I hate myself.